Private.
we were able to purchase new bags, and all the bags are decorated by our kids. So even if you aren't a kid, I invite you to look at the bags because they're really like just creative and decorated. It was just full of life and for how we engage in worship here. And so I invite you, as we get started, over these next 4 weeks, we will be kind of what I'd say going off script a little bit and leaving the lectionary a little bit. The lectionary is kind of that set rhythm of our gospel texts and our scriptural texts. But over the next 4 weeks, we are going to be beginning, starting today, talking about the spirit of generosity and what that means. So look in the mail. You should be getting a mailing with that information. If not, by Tuesday, if you haven't received one, you can pick up extra copies here at church, or just simply come and talk to me or one of our council members about this and what we are doing. But it's going to be some good times, I think, as we explore what it means to be generous and engaged here at Redeemer. So welcome, and we are glad that you are here. Let us begin with our confession and forgiveness that you can find printed in your bulletin. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God who is eager to forgive and who loves us beyond our days.
Amen. Amen.
Dear friends, let us acknowledge our failure to love the world as Jesus does. And so we offer a moment of silent reflection as we confess our sins in the presence of God. I invite you to join me. God of all mercy and forgiveness, we confess that sin still has a hold on us. We have harmed your good creation. We have failed to do justice, love kindness, and walk humbly with you.
Turn us in the new direction. Show us the path that leads to life. Be our refuge and strength on the journey. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and friend.
Know this, that you, as God's beloveds, that your sin is forgiven, and that you are made whole. And God points the way to life in Christ, who meets us on the road. Journey now in God's abiding love through the power of the Holy Spirit.
Amen. Amen.
Let us join in our prayer for the day. Generous God, daily your mercy surprises us with everlasting forgiveness. Strengthen our hope in you and grant that all peoples of earth may find their glory in you. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord.
Amen.
You may be seated and I'll be here with the word. And I get the special treat of getting to read both of our texts this morning. And so our first reading. Our first reading comes from the Old Testament, actually at the very beginning in Genesis, and it's Genesis 1, 27 through 31. And it reads like this. So God created humans in God's image. In the image of God, God created them. Male and female, God created them. God blessed them, and God said to them, be fruitful and multiply and fill the earth and subdue it, and have dominion over the fish of the sea and the birds of the air and every living thing that moves upon the earth, God said. See, I have given you every plant yielding seed that is upon the face of all the earth, and every tree with seed in it, its fruit, so you shall have them for food. And to every beast of the earth, and to every bird of the air, and to everything that creeps on the earth, everything that has breath of life, I have given every green plant for food. And it was so. God saw everything that God had made, and indeed, it was very good. And there was evening, and there was morning, the sixth day. I invite you to stand for our gospel affirmation. went to the other side of the Sea of Galilee, also called the Sea of Tiberias. A large crowd kept following him because they saw the signs that he was doing for the sick. Jesus went up the mountain and sat down there with his disciples. Now the Passover, the festival of the Jews, was nearing, and he looked up and saw a large crowd coming towards him. Jesus said to Philip, "Where are we to buy bread for these people to eat?" He said this to test him, for he himself knew what he was going to do. Philip answered him, 200 denarii would not buy enough bread for each of them to get a little." One of his disciples, Andrew, Simon Peter's brother, said to him, "There's a boy here, and he has brought 5 barley loaves and 2 fish. But what are they among so many people?" Jesus said, "Make the people sit down." Now there was a great deal of grass in this place, so they all sat down, about 5,000 in all. Then Jesus took the loaves, and when he had given thanks, he distributed them to those who were seated, so also the fish, as much as they wanted. When they were satisfied, he told the disciples, "Gather up the fragmented leftovers, so that nothing may be lost." So they gathered them up, and from the fragments of the 5 barley loaves left by those who had eaten, they filled 12 baskets. When the people saw the sign that he had done, they began to say, "This is indeed the prophet who has come into the world." The gospel of our Lord.
Thanks be to God.
You may be seated, and I invite our kids to come forward. I know we have a couple of friends with us. I'm just going to grab my mask here. This is that piece. I hope I don't crackle too much. I just want to keep us safe since we're close together. Because, unfortunately, I think around a few people that COVID is still around. And so, I'm just being safe today. So, our story. I have a story book to read for us. So I'm going to sit here on the ground with you all, because that's what I typically do at home, is sit with my kids when I read. And yes, I do have treats for you too. And I think since there's just 2 of you, you could get 2 treats today. How about that? So this one, our first story, we talked about God's creation. And that God created all of us, right? In God's image. So this book is by Matthew Paul Turner. And it's illustrated by David Catrell. And it's called When God Made You. And it says, You, when God made you, God made you all shiny and new. An incredible you. A you all of your own. And unlike anyone else ever known. An exclusive design, one God redefined. You're perfectly crafted, a one of a kind. Because God, when God made you, somehow God knew that the world needed someone exactly like you. You. God thinks about you. God thinks about you even long before your debut. God imagined your eyes, your head shape and size. God knew what you looked like when you felt surprised. God pictured your nose and all 10 of your toes. The sound of your voice, God had it composed. The lines on your hands, every hair and every strand, God knew every detail like it was all planned. Out of billions of faces, of cultures and races, people, God made from all different places. God knew your name Your picture is framed. God's family without you would not be the same. Because when God made you, this much is true. The world got to meet who God already knew. Look at all those people. Because God loves you, creating your true self. When light on the inside through art is portraying, when you make believe, do you do that? Do you pretend? Maybe a little. I know as an adult I do too. The stories, conceive the heroics, the magic, those tricks up your sleeves. When you dance alone, spinning like a cyclone, being whoever, whatever in the world all your own. God smiles, and here's why. In the spark of your eye, a familiar reflection shines bright from inside. A dreamer who dreams in big and small things, who keeps dreaming in journeys upstream. A mover, a shaker, a lover of nature. A you who views others as sisters and brothers and lives by three words, love one another. You being you is God's dream coming true. Because when God made you, all of heaven was beaming. Over you, God was smiling and already dreaming. The end. I know it's a longer story, but I love how it's this brave and bold and amazing reminder of you. I know they snatched those snacks. So thank you, friends. I'm glad you could join us. And I invite you off of this book out so you all can see it, because I invite you to look at the pictures, the illustrations of God's amazing creativity. Now, as I share the message, I am going to use the music stand and move out here and stay out here with you. I've got to kind of keep here so the folks online can also see with this mask. This microphone is getting caught in my hair. But you, beautiful you. Isn't that a remarkable reminder? For you, in all the places and spaces that we get to go. I'm excited to read this story. It's a story that I have heard throughout my growing up in the church. I have been a part of a church community pretty much since the day I was born. On and off, I've had different communities and they look different ways, but I've always been connected to what God is up to in the world. And I love this story because this story shows us how anyone at any age can be engaged and can make a difference. Did you know that this story about the loaves and the fishes shows up in every single gospel? So I think it's quite important that we listen to this story. But it is only in John where a boy provides the meal. A little kid provides the first loaves and fish. Now, I imagine that in John's fashion, the author of this gospel, that Jesus himself does bless the food and distribute it. But it is through this boy, this creative first action of generosity, that everything gets started. And so, I really appreciate how we celebrate everyone of all ages getting the opportunity to play a role in God's community. Imagine with me Jesus and his disciples gathered, possibly getting ready to have their own small group time. Remember, they left all the work that they had been doing. This is kind of a break, a little discipleship retreat, I imagine. They go up on this hill, and they're visiting with each other, and this giant crowd follows them. They have only prepared and planned for it to be their group. But word got out, and this small group turned into this sold-out, packed venue, is what I picture, as if Jesus is the headliner for some motivational, like, giant revival, amazing, transformative event. They didn't plan for this at all. And yet Jesus doesn't turn anyone away. And it is so remarkable that Jesus looks at the crowd and without skipping a beat or hesitation, says, how are we going to do this? He says, okay, we're going to get some more lunches because simply, we have to feed the people who are here. Now what happens next, in my imagination, if you are a person who is experiencing, has any experience with kids, you might agree with me on this. If you are at an event, it is sometimes hard to keep track of where your kids are. So it doesn't surprise me that the boy has ran off from his family and has somehow made his way to eavesdropping on Jesus and the disciples. And I pictured that as the adults are talking and this child is running around and playing, this child notices something. Even when we adults get stuck in our thinking, I love the creativity that a new, fresh perspective can bring. And they're surprised because this little boy in his eavesdropping on Jesus and the disciples is moved by the Spirit that is present there with all of them. And he's moved to generosity, to thinking outside of himself. And so I imagine he then sprints down this mountain, or maybe rolls down, I don't know what his energy is like, but rolls down this mountain and gets to his family and says, bye mom and dad, as he runs off with the basket of food. And I imagine as the parents being like, wait a second, that was our only meal that we had, and oh, did that boy get snack. Ooh, is he gonna be in trouble? I imagine the parents just like, what? The family not aware of where their boy is or what is he thinking in this moment? Well, what the boy is thinking is that he's about ready to be this catalyst for this explosion of generosity. Oh, that moment when the boy holds up this basket, this little meal of goldfish crackers and fruit and whatever else they were having. Humbled by this child's actions, Jesus blesses this food and then goes and distributes it out to the people in need. I imagine this child who saw this need dream up a solution and then modeled it for Jesus. Jesus and this child are in partnership with showing everyone around what radical love and gestures of generosity can do. Jesus for himself knew what was going on. I love that Jesus didn't take the actions first in this story of John, but that he knew the Spirit was already at work in, with, and through this young child. I believe that that miracle was that the boy's actions created a pattern for others to follow. That it wasn't a magical act performed The spirit of generosity was moving and shaking one by one. The children, the elders, and all present had a feast among themselves. Everyone had a role. This community's lives were impacted in a big way, I imagine. And I hope that for days to come after this, that they went back and they were motivated. They felt something that day. And their community found growth, found healing, found this amazing opportunity in the giftedness that each one of them held. So I wonder, does one's age or the size of the gift in acting generously matter? Does the giving of others to others inspire us? And then I also wonder, who has modeled generosity for you? Generous and what it is. As we plan here at Redeemer, I've said this several times, we're in this retime, redevelopment, renewal, rebuilding, reimagination. That for us, as we get ready to end in 2022 and look forward to setting our goals for 2023, we may celebrate all the ages for being examples of generosity. May we be open for committing, making that stretch goal, whether it's you haven't been in this place engaging and volunteering at the same capacity in the last couple of years. What would that look like for you? Say yes to doing something, coming back to something you've done before, or re-engaging with something you've never tried before here. Or what would it look like to think about a different plan for your family, to contribute to the ways in which we get to literally be the hands and feet of Jesus in the world, to make a difference, to be those forward thinkers about caring for creation, who are organizing and changing the world for the better. Whether we are kids, whether we identify as elders, whether we are somewhere in between, for those of us, may we be curious about learning how to practice generosity. And may we lean into leading, because each one of you have that capacity to lead in ways of being generous in spirit. We get to lay this foundation in this here and now, not just for 2023, but where will we be in 2033, 2043, and way beyond. This congregation is 112 years old. Think of all the history from that first day they broke ground. There's a place and a role for all of us. So let's give thanks to God, and let's give thanks to each other, because we're going to figure this out in this journey together. Amen. And speaking of restarting things, yep, worship team, you can come forward, because I asked one of our families to be our ushers today. So this is something we haven't done in a while, so we're going to receive our those gifts of generosity that contribute to being the hands and feet. If you are giving online, or if you are still contemplating what a gift would look like, I want you to know there is no obligation, no guilt, no shame you should feel So we're going to pass the plates, and then we're going to give thanks, and we're going to sing while we do it.
Thank you.
and we prayed for the whole people of God. And so after each petition, I invite you as I say, God, in your mercy, as that you say, hear our prayer. Let us pray. Merciful God, we praise you for your unfailing love and the boundless creativity that you have, and the ways in which we have been created in your image. May we continue to live that out. Love and kindness and creativity and imagination bestowed within us. We praise you for feeding our hungry spirits, for being the bread of life. Keep stirring up in us the awareness to acknowledge and respond to the needs of others. God, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Our empowering force, we ask that you look over and care with your healing touch for those who are sick. We ask for your compassion on those who are suffering in this world. We ask for comfort for those who are grieving, for all who are lonely, especially those who have newly arrived in unfamiliar cities or countries. For those who are political prisoners without recourse for justice, for hospital patients who still aren't allowed visitors, for any who are ill and struggling with just need and sense for longing. We pray for those who are hearts and minds and those within the Redeemer community. We pray for Mary, for Claudia, for Jane, Branch family, for Caroline, for Jimmy. We pray for those who currently are dealing with a case of COVID-19. We pray for Mama and Ava. We pray for those who are suffering from long COVID or coronavirus pandemic, for caregivers everywhere. God, in mercy. We thank you for your daily grace, and God, we call upon you to embolden us as we declare who you are to a world who needs you. We call upon you, Lord Jesus, to inspire us as we seek to inspire others. We call upon you, Lord Jesus, to strengthen us in our own weakness. We call upon you, Lord Jesus, to open us up to your love and your pleasure. God, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We ask all this in Jesus' name. Amen. when we visit at home in our house, and we're trying to send people back on a meal, everyone's just like energized though, because they want to keep talking. And so whether you are at home or here, I hope we continue with that energy as we have set the table, as we prepare to receive this meal that will not just simply nourish our bodies, but give us strength for what lies ahead in this next week. And so we are reminded as Jesus gathered around the table with his disciples, he took bread and he broke it, and he gave it to each of them, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body broken for you. Do this in memory of me always." And then after supper, he took the cup and he set it for the thanks over it, saying, This is the new promise found in my blood, shed for you and for all of you. Drink this and remember me always." And in one spirit, we were taught to pray. And so I invite you to join in the Lord's Prayer. If you need to, the words are in your bulletin. Let us join our voices. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Amen. A few instructions as you come and receive your meal. For those in person, there is hand sanitizer if you need it. There are the communion cups for the wine or the juice. If you would grab one before you come and receive the bread. And we'll kind of make like a line that goes all the way this way, because there's a basket over here on your left to put the empty cup. After you've received the bread and after you've received the wine, you just drop that cup there. There's gluten-free available as needed. If you wish to have a blessing, May the Holy Trinity, one God, guide you always. think of that if you have anniversaries or birthdays. We might try doing this more to share and celebrate. If there is a middle school or high school around, whether you're at home, there's still time for you to drive on over after worship. We're going to get together just to meet and greet, just to greet each other, because then there's a jump remix that is happening today over at Christ, the River of Life. And so we hope that you can come and join us. That's from 1 to 3 today. So if you could make it and show up, it's just a time for fellowship. Just a time to touch base, to see how you're doing, to say hello, all of those things. Whew, next Sunday, are you ready? You can get your flu shot! If you need a flu shot, I invite you to come and get your flu shot from 10 to 12:30. And then you can go downstairs because we're having our soul food dinner potluck. So I invite you to come and have a meal. There's a sign-up list out in the narthex area on the table that I invite you, if you are interested in coming on Saturday, whether it's to cook the dish that you want to prepare using the Redeemer Kitchen, or to help us set up and decorate tables. And then on Sunday, we would love to have some additional hands for helping to serve, as well as to help with cleanup at the end of the meal. So if that's something you are capable of doing and interested in, and all of those things, you know, I was really grateful to hear this piece of wisdom, that it's not what we have on the table, but that it's about us gathering around the table. So we look forward to having you gather with us around the table to share a meal. There will be takeout boxes, so if you are still not feeling comfortable about eating a meal next to somebody yet, you can come and pick up your meal and just say hi and wave to us and then take it home and eat and enjoy too. So we are trying to live in this like hybrid community of trying to keep people healthy and safe. And so, all those things. Is there anyone else who has any community like announcements for the good of this whole group? Kent, please.
Good morning, Minnesotans. So, anybody's interested in helping to turn out the vote for this upcoming election, talk to me. Some of you know my spouse is an elected official, and she's actually running a post, so we're really focusing on turnout to demonstrate, especially in like the lowest turnout areas, in specifically North Minneapolis. And so we've been doing a lot of door knocks in apartment buildings, and so if you're interested in helping people to turn out to vote, let me know, and we can chat about that. So thank you. We have lots of door knocks.
Yes, and so put your name, there's two pieces of paper that we put out there if you're interested for voter registration information and help out there on the narthex table as well. So that will also help Kent and myself and everyone who's organizing for you to put your name and phone number down for door knocking or passing out information. So amazing things. I think we should sing our dismissal. So if you haven't joined us in person before, we're going to sing our dismissal.